Hello everybody and welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and in the last video we began our discussion of helmets with the Great Helm, and in today's video we will be moving on to my personal favorite style of helmet, and that is the bassinet with a hard T. So it's important to begin our discussion of the bassinet with its predecessor, the Cervelier, or the skull cap helm that we looked at in the last video. If you remember, the skull cap was basically a smaller, low-profile, basically hemispherical helmet that sat directly atop the head. It could be worn under a male coif, it could be worn over a male coif, and it was typically used in conjunction with the early 14th century style great helms. Over time, the skull cap began to become more refined and would eventually become a more substantial and eventually standalone helmet. It took a couple of different paths. So if you look at the skull cap, you always see it kind of married up with a male coif. That male coif is a distinct, discrete piece of mail worn, basically a male hood, and then the helmet worn in addition to that. Over time, they began to eliminate that redundancy of having mail basically under the part of your head that was already protected by a helmet. And as they refined it, they began to incorporate the mail directly into the helmet. So you see pretty early on the attachment of the mail directly to the bottom edge of the helmet, creating the aventail. So now the mail is part of the helmet instead of a discrete object worn in addition to the helmet. The shape also becomes more refined over time, and the helmet becomes more substantial, so it starts to enclose more of the head than just sit directly on top of the head. And then as it becomes a true bassinet, we see different ways to deal with protection for the face. So the first way, and one of the most commonly ways it's depicted, is with no direct protection for the face. So basically an open face bassinet, very similar to what we saw in the last video, the bassinet that I wore under the example Great Helm. The open face bassinet would last pretty much the entire lifespan of the bassinet as it existed in the medieval period. We'll always see open face bassinets, or at the very least, people who have discarded or lost their visors if they were wearing them. But the open face bassinet does lend itself to certain situations. The first is it's very easy to wear under a great helm. There's no visor to interfere with that fit. And the other major advantage is that you have virtually unrestricted vision. You may get some restriction of peripheral vision because of the edge of the helmet. But forward vision, being able to see up and down, is virtually unrestricted in an open face bassinet. And the other big thing is your ability to breathe. So there's nothing interfering with air exchange. You have that unlimited capacity to breathe. And being able to see and breathe on the battlefield are a pretty big deal, especially when you're fighting in combat and you're basically at maximum physical exertion for an extended period of time. Anybody who's done any martial arts knows that being able to breathe especially is a pretty big deal. And it's also important to consider that because there's no direct protection for the face, it doesn't mean that your face is completely unprotected. Anything but a direct attack directly to the face should hit your helmet first, but again, it's not going to offer the same level of protection that a true dedicated visor or other form of direct facial protection would offer. So the other path to that, it was the development of the visor. So instead of wearing an open face bassinet, some development paths show that full visor pretty early on. So pretty early in the 14th century, one of the earliest forms of visors that we see for the bassinet is the early side pivoting visor. A side pivoting visor has a pivot on either side of the skull that allows the visor to be raised and lowered in that fashion. The earliest forms of visors that we see on the bassinet and would remain pretty common for the first half of the 14th century are pretty low profile visors. They're pretty flat and streamlined in shape. Nothing like you see in the distinct late 14th century houndskull bassinet, where the snout of the visor is very distinctly pointed. There was kind of a middle option too that showed up around the 1330s and kind of lasted into the 1370s. That was most commonly depicted in German-speaking countries, and that is the Bretache. It does exist outside of that geographical region, but much less commonly than it shows up there. The Bretache is basically a rigid nasal that is attached to the aventail at the chin, and then you could take that nasal and draw it up over the face and lock it onto the central part of the skull of the bassinet. So now, once in place, you actually had a rigid nasal that protected the center line of the face. So it's kind of the compromise between a full visor and a true open face bassinet. You could probably still wear a great helm with a Bretache on very easily if you needed to, because it's so low profile. When you're not wearing a great helm, you still have protection for the face, not as good as a true visor, but enough that now anything directly going into the either side of that nasal is fairly well protected. And of course, because the eyes aren't covered, you still have excellent vision when wearing a Bretache, as opposed to a full visor, which will restrict your vision inevitably. Moving into about the 1360s, so right at the very tail end of the 1350s, maybe one or two examples in artwork, like 1359, and then definitively in 1360 is when we see kind of the next major development of the bassinet, and that is the development of the clap visor bassinet. So it's important to note that when you say clap visor bassinet, it refers specifically to the hinge mechanism of how the visor works. It doesn't refer to the style of visor. So clap visor bassinets come in many different shapes and styles of visors, but what they all have in common is a centrally pivoting hinge directly in the center of the skull here, so that the visor raises and lowers on that central pivot. The earlier forms of clap visor bassinets are usually similar to what we see in the earlier side pivoting visors, where they're relatively flat in profile. Nothing too distinct like the later houndskulls. But over time, we do see clap visor bassinets that end up adopting that conical snout, just utilizing a clap visor hinge instead of a side pivot. The clap visor bassinet, so from about 1360, and it would last into the early 15th century of examples that go into the early 15th century. Moving a little bit later into the 14th century, so right about the last quarter of the 14th century, and probably closer to about 1380, is when we really see the that definitive kind of iconic and my favorite style of helmet, the true houndskull bassinet. So that's what I have examples of here, kind of two evolutionary steps in the development of the houndskull visor, but very distinct shape now, that side pivoting visor, very extended pointed nose, and the reason that it's developed like that is it's an excellent glancing surface. So any weapon that comes from the front and hits that nose, there's nowhere for it to really gain purchase, but it's going to slide off the helmet. The other thing that we see with bassinets at this time is that now we have a huge variety of skull shapes too. So back point bassinets, kind of central point bassinets, less distinct points on bassinets, subtle shaping differences, but all of them kind of retain that very streamlined rounded shape on top, again, to encourage bladed weapons to glance off the surface, so that it's very difficult to deliver the full force of a blow into the helmet. At the very end of the 14th century, that's when we start to see that transition from the true bassinet into what would eventually become the great bassinet. So one of the distinct differences is the integration of rigid throat defense directly into the helmet itself. In the very end of the 14th century, in the turn of the 14th, 15th century, we start to see experimentation of the addition of plates to houndskull bassinets and different styles of bassinets, but basically a plate that covers the throat, usually in addition to the aventail. So we see examples of basically a houndskull bassinet with a throat plate and then the aventail peeking out from under that. We see more rounded forms of bassinet visors with the same thing, a throat plate across the neck and then the aventail peeking out from under that throat plate. And then eventually what happens is we see a fully integrated rigid throat defense directly integrated into that helmet, making the aventail completely redundant, and then the aventail goes away. The visors on great bassinets tend to be of the more early 15th century style of more rounded as opposed to more distinctly pointed visors as well. Eventually on the battlefield, the bassinet, the use of the bassinet would kind of wane. We do see it here and there over time as we move forward into the 15th century, but it would really give way to the what would become a much more popular style of helmet in the armet and sallet that would basically dominate the international landscape of helmets in the 15th century. The bassinet, however, did kind of find a little bit of an extended life on the tournament field. Into the mid-15th century, we see examples of more refined bassinets that are specifically designed to be used in tournament fighting. It's also important to note another style of bassinet that would be called the what we modernly call Venetian-style great bassinets. And they're very distinct looking. They're a very distinct looking style of bassinet, usually a very, very low profile visor. But what's important to note about them is a lot of them started to incorporate early hinged cheek plates that would eventually be adopted by early armets and, become much more commonplace as the armet reached its full development. All right, so we're going to take a look at this helmet specifically now. This helmet was made for me by a very gifted armorer by the name of Piotr Ferret. He is a gentleman from Poland, and I'm going to put a link in the description below to his website so that you guys can go check it out. And I highly recommend you go look at it and see some of the really, really nice work that he does. So obviously this part of the bassinet here is called the skull, and then this is the visor of the bassinet. The first thing I want to direct your attention to is right here. These are the pivots. So this is a side pivoting bassinet, and that's what allows the visor to be raised and lowered, and it just pivots on that hinge here, on this pivot here. And then this is what we call the hinge. It's shaped like a hinge, but it doesn't actually need to hinge open or close like a door. What it is doing is it's allowing the visor to be attached. So the visor is removable, and you can see that there are pins going through the hinge here. That pin can be removed, and then the visor pulls away from the helmet. On this particular visor, you'll also note that I have a chain from the pin attached to the visor itself, so that when the pin is removed, it's a lot harder to lose the pins that are associated with that visor. We see those historically on some visors, and a lot of visors we don't see them, so they were done sometimes, they were not done other times. But I'm going to go ahead and pull the pin so that I can remove the visor. happened. Now you can see everything that was under the visor there. So you'll notice there's a leather band that goes around the bottom of the helmet. The Aventail is sewn directly to that leather band. You can see the stitching here on the leather band that's attaching the Aventail. The reason that it was done like this is so that the Aventail could be removed if necessary to be repaired, cleaned, whatever you needed to do to service the Aventail. These studs that you see here are what are called vervails, and they're basically a hollow post that goes through the helmet and is attached permanently to the skull of the helmet, but it leaves a hole on the surface so that the leather band can be placed over those, and then a cord passed through the holes on the vervails to secure that leather band in place, and that's how the Aventail is actually attached to the helmet itself. If you look at this little diagram here, you'll see that on a bassinet that doesn't have the Aventail anymore, there's a lot of different holes drilled along the edges of the helmet itself. You'll see where the vervails are, and then if you follow the vervails up the facial opening, you'll note that there are two holes where the original vervails have been lost. So those are the holes that the vervails get attached through. And then closer to the edge of the helmet, you'll see a series of much closer spaced holes. And those are the holes that are for attaching the liner of the bassinet. So again, if you look at my helmet, you'll see that the holes are here and there's thread through them. So there's linen thread here that is actually sewing the padded liner that's worn on the inside of the bassinet in place. So again, it's removable. You simply cut the thread, pull the thread out, and the entire padded liner is removable from the helmet to be cleaned, repaired, replaced, whatever needs to be done. Okay, taking a look at the visors, I have two different visor style here. The first visor is made in the style of the Wallace A69, and the second visor here is made in the style of the Sherberg CH16 visor. These are kind of evolutionary steps in visor design. So the tail end of the 14th century, you really see more favored in design this pointed style of visor. And it would kind of last into the 15th century as well. But what becomes more commonly depicted right around 1400 and into the first years of the 15th century is this more rounded style of visor. So I wanted to be able to show that difference. You'll also notice that there are other differences, other stylistic differences in these two visors. You have individual oculars here, individual sights to see from. On this one, it's one sight all the way across, and obviously the big difference too is this is just a single narrow slit, whereas this is a barred ocular. So you may be able to see a little bit better through something like this, but this is a good place for a weapon to penetrate. There's a trade-off here. You can only make them so narrow until you just can't see anymore. But at the same time, this is a place for a weapon to get into this helmet, even though it's relatively unlikely to get in. Having something like this, it may impede vision a little bit more, but it's a lot harder to get a weapon into one of those individual bars than it might be to get through something like this. You'll also notice that on the bottom of the visor, on this one, it has what, for lack of a better term, looks like a mouth, and this one has nothing. When I'm wearing these visors, what I like about that mouth is that I can look through it, so it's hard to see through the breaths. It's not that easy to look through those little holes. You do get a sense of what's out there, but it's not as easy as looking through the actual sights. The mouth on that visor basically offers sights that allow you to survey the ground below. But again, that compromise between true protection and vision and things like that, this is another place for a weapon to penetrate. And there's no such weakness on this particular visor, but you do lose that ability to survey the ground as easily as you can in this visor. The other big difference well, not between these two, but what we'll look at here is asymmetry in the breaths. So the holes on the sides of the visor are called breaths, so they're there for air exchange so that you can, you know, to facilitate breathing in the helmet. But you'll notice on these particular visors, there are only breaths drilled on the right side of the helmet. In extant examples, we see plenty of visors that are symmetrical, so they have breaths on both sides. We also see a lot of visors that are asymmetrical, where they only have breaths on one side or very few breaths on one side as compared to the other side. But what you will notice is the consistency that the side that does have breaths or the side that has more breaths is always on the right side of the visor. And there's a reason for that. Imagine somebody making a cavalry charge or two people approaching each other on horseback with lances. The lance is going to be couched under the right arm of the rider. That means that the horses are going to pass left to left. It also means that the lance strike you're about to take in your face is likely going to strike the left side of the helmet. So this is the stronger side of the helmet. So while this does reduce the ability to exchange air and breathe less impeded, it makes the left side of your helmet significantly stronger because it's the side of the helmet that's more likely to take a strike. Even on the ground, most people are right-handed, and in the Middle Ages, if you weren't right-handed, you were probably highly encouraged to fight right-handed. Now imagine a right-handed person swinging a sword with their right hand. If you're facing me, that's going to strike the left side. Again, with a pole arm, it's more comfortable for me to swing from that power side. So in a melee, swinging from the right side, more likely to strike on the left side. That's the more defended side of the helmet. So again, do you want to be able to breathe better and have less impedance on your ability to exchange air? Or do you want that more protected helmet? We see plenty of examples of both in surviving helmets. The shape of the helmet itself, the profile is the most obvious thing, and like we alluded to before, it is a defensive measure. The helmet is a series of compound curves and glancing surfaces. So when arrows or bladed weapons come from the front, they hit this, they're going to glance off. Even the shape of the skull itself, very distinct peak at the top, compound curves, anything coming from the top, it's going to hit that helmet and be encouraged to glance off from one side. So very difficult to deliver the full force of impact into the person wearing the helmet because there are no flat surfaces presented to the weapon that's striking it. So it's a very practical helmet design in addition to having that kind of very striking, iconic look of the late 14th and early 15th century. So in the early 15th century, with that great bassinet starting to take off and becoming more common at something like Agincourt in 1415, very likely that you would see a mix of earlier style true bassinets with a full aventail with the typical houndskull visor or the more rounded visor, and then on perhaps more the higher end armors, newer armors, you would start to see that true great bassinet with fully integrated rigid throat defense, foregoing the aventail entirely. Okay, so I'm going to put one of the visors back on the helmet, and then I will put it on to show you what it looks like being worn on a person. Okay, so what I'm gonna do now is put the helmet on, and I'm just gonna talk you through what I'm gonna do once it's on so you know what I'm doing. At first, I'll just kind of move around so you can see the kind of movement that I get. And then I'm going to show you the field of vision that I get from the helmet. So what I'll do is, once it's on, I'll have the visor down. I'm going to put my hands out to the side and slowly move my hands forward until I can see my hands with my peripheral vision. And then you'll have an idea of what my actual field of view is with the visor down, looking through the sights. And then, of course, you can raise the visor. I can get a quick survey of the battlefield, see what I need to see, take a full deep breath if I need to, and then when it's time to go again, lower the visor to protect myself. But what I hope you notice is on the peripheral vision test, I think my hands were about here. That's still a pretty wide field of view compared to what I think most people assume you get in a helmet like this. If the sights are aligned properly with your eyes and the helmet sits properly on your head, then you should still maintain a pretty decent field of vision, certainly enough to make the helmet very usable in an actual situation where you'd be wearing it. You're definitely not looking through soda straws like I think a lot of people assume that you are when you're wearing a helmet like this. Okay guys, so that's everything I wanted to cover in the bassinet video. I have a feeling that this video is already pretty long, so I know other people are interested in more specifics like the comparison of vision between this visor and that visor and things like that. So in the future, what I will do is make a video specifically about that so that we can take kind of a closer look at things like that. I also hope to get my hands on a high-quality grate bassinet so that you can see the difference between how a grate bassinet works with that full rigid throat defense, how that affects movement and things like that as compared to a more traditional bassinet with an Aventail. But that's it. So if you like the video, please give me a thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. Share the video with your friends. And please feel free to follow me on Facebook. The link is down in the description below. Thank you very much. Obviously, I'm having an inside weight pull-out if I wear it, and visualize what's happening. But first thing yes, it does show is being Robert McPherson, as I squat down and point down the motor, and see the fall collapse. So it translates very nicely to your transformation to use it, so the leather tabs on top of the motor, while still great signs of protection properly to make sure that the sights you also note that the eyes, upper edge of the breast, and that is achieved through that internal suspension. Strapping inside the great collar that I'm wearing.